Hello, and welcome to the Amgen Disease State Educational National Broadcast, Opportunities to Further Care in ANCA-Associated Vasculitis, with a focus on granulomatosis with polyangiitis, or GPA, and microscopic polyangiitis, or MPA. My name is Dr. Alexandra Villa-Forte from the Center for Vasculitis Care and Research at the Department of Rheumatologic and Immunologic Diseases at the Cleveland Clinic. I'm joined by my colleague, Dr. Cortazar.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Frank Cortazar, and I'm the director of the New York Nephrology, Vasculitis, and Glomerular Center. It is a pleasure to be here with you today to speak about the challenges and opportunities we face in this disease state.
Before we get started, I'd like to walk through some disclosures. This presentation is sponsored by Amgen, and we have been compensated for our time and expertise. The content in this presentation has been reviewed consistent with Amgen's internal review policies. All materials are the property of Amgen and may not be recorded, photographed, copied, or otherwise reproduced.
In today's presentation, we want to highlight that GPA and MPA are chronic and progressive autoimmune diseases that cause small to medium vessel vasculitis, damaging the vasculature throughout the body. Patients often present with severe active disease characterized by heterogeneous signs and symptoms affecting multiple organ systems. Identifying the variable presentation of severe active disease across patients may help improve diagnosis and management in the service of achieving the goal of sustained remission.
Yes, and common approaches to achieving the goal of sustained remission tend to target the humoral response or use a broad-based approach to dampening general immune responses. It's important to note that patients with GPA and MPA can continue to experience significant morbidity from disease relapse and treatment-related toxicity that could impair organ function and reduce quality of life. And it's important for clinicians to understand the range of discrete mechanisms underlying this disease, such as complement-mediated interactions, and how each mechanism contributes to disease pathophysiology. By doing so, we as clinicians may be better equipped to make informed management decisions.
Before jumping into learning more about the disease, let's set the stage with a hypothetical case representing the type of patient we might see in our practice. Jane is a 52-year-old teacher presenting to your office with complaints of fatigue, joint pains, and headaches over the past few months. She has noted weight loss and a rash involving her arms and legs, which waxes and wanes. Jane also notes sinus congestion and headaches. And recently, she has noticed a change in the color of her urine. Jane has been seen by her primary care physician and an allergist who had previously started her on different antibiotic courses that did not alleviate her sinus symptoms. She is now presenting in your office for further evaluation. On physical exam, you see erythematous nasal mucosa with crusting, lower extremity edema, new hypertension, and purpura on the lower extremities. Dr. Villa-Forte, at first glance, what aspect of Jane's case stand out to you?
For me, what stands out in Jane's case are the multisystemic manifestations, including weight loss, joint pains, lower extremity edema, and sinus and nasal symptoms. At this point, I would be looking for a disease that can be manifest across multiple organ systems. Specifically, Jane's case is an example of a patient who may have ANCA-associated vasculitis, which we'll see more clearly as the case progresses. ANCA-associated vasculitis is a group of relatively rare but severe systemic autoimmune diseases characterized by inflammatory cell infiltration leading to necrosis of predominantly small to medium-sized blood vessels and impact on critical organs. ANCA-associated vasculitis consists of three disease entities: microscopic polyangiitis, or MPA, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, GPA, and eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis, or EGPA. In today's presentation, we'll focus on GPA and MPA. Dr. Cortazar, how might you characterize some of the differences between these two disease entities?
Both GPA and MPA are characterized by necrotizing vasculitis affecting small to medium vessels, often involving the kidneys, lungs, and peripheral nerves. GPA, however, involves a necrotizing granulomatous inflammation, often involving the upper and lower respiratory tracts, but other organs can be affected. Photos A through C on the right provide examples of images and exam findings that might be found in patients with GPA or MPA. In image A, we can see sinonasal disease with coronal CT images showing destruction of the nasal septum, inferior turbinates, and right middle turbinate in a newly diagnosed patient. Image B shows a chest CT with ground glass opacities in a patient with ANCA-associated vasculitis with acute pulmonary hemorrhage. Image C demonstrates scleritis in a patient with GPA. Now that we understand what GPA and MPA are, let's take a closer look at how they develop.
Regarding mechanism of disease, the pathophysiology of GPA and MPA is driven by components of both humoral immunity and the alternative complement system. The process begins with loss of immune tolerance to self-antigens, myeloperoxidase, or MPO, and or proteinase 3, PR3, and production of antineutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies, or ANCA, by circulating self-reactive B cells. Primed by cytokines, and particularly alternative complement system protein, C5a, neutrophils will present MPO and or PR3 antigens. Binding of ANCA to these primed neutrophils will lead to neutrophil activation. This activated neutrophil then migrate to and infiltrate the vascular endothelium, where they release destructive mediators through nidosis and degranulation that perpetuated vascular inflammation and damage. At this time, more C5a is released, which recruits and primes additional neutrophils, leading to an amplification loop that drives inflammation and vascular damage.
Yes, and it's the vascular damage caused by activated neutrophils throughout the body that leads to the heterogeneous manifestations we see in clinical practice. Note that most patients will present with severe disease as defined by life or organ-threatening manifestations. Examples of some of these common manifestations are listed here. However, it is also important to recognize other manifestations that indicate disease activity. Monitor for signs and symptoms such as myalgia, arthralgia, fever, weight loss, skin lesions, and mouth ulcers. You may also see conjunctivitis and uveitis, nasal discharge, crusting or ulceration, and pleurisy. These may appear before or alongside life or organ-threatening manifestations as signs of active disease. Also remember that active disease can represent both new, worsening, or persistent signs or symptoms attributed to GPA or MPA that are not related to prior disease damage. So Dr. Villa-Forte, given what we know about the presentation of GPA and MPA, what should we consider during diagnosis?
Well, because of the heterogeneous and often nonspecific presentation of GPA and MPA, multisystemic involvement is often the clue that leads to diagnosis. For this reason, a careful and systematic approach to clinical assessment across multiple organ systems is critical for diagnosis. A supportive tool for diagnosis can include serology. However, it's important to note that while positive ANCA serology can help support diagnosis, up to 20% of patients with GPA and MPA may be ANCA negative. It's also important to consider that ANCA positivity can also be found in other conditions without associated vasculitis, such as autoimmune hepatitis, ulcerative colitis, hepatitis C, HIV, or infectious endocarditis. Biopsy can be another supportive tool that can be confirmatory, particularly in cases with renal, pulmonary, or skin involvement, but treatment should not be delayed simply to get a biopsy.
That's a great point. Let's take a moment to apply what we've discussed to our patient case. Recall that Jane originally presented with a constellation of signs and symptoms concerning for a multisystemic disease process with ENT, joint, cutaneous, and renal manifestations that point to severe active disease. Labs now show reduced kidney function, hematuria and proteinuria, elevated ESR, and positive ANCA serology that help support our clinical assessment. ENT involvement and serology steer us towards a diagnosis of severe active GPA over MPA. Given the renal involvement in this patient, I would also consider a renal biopsy. However, biopsy collection in this patient should not delay initiation of appropriate therapy. Pictured on the right side, we see an example of what a renal biopsy might show in a patient with ANCA-associated vasculitis. Slide A shows severe interstitial inflammation, as depicted by the arrow. Slide B, in the same patient, shows segmental necrotizing and crescentic glomerulonephritis. Consider what other disease manifestations you may encounter with Jane if her disease progresses and what goals of care you might try to achieve while working with her. Dr. Villa-Forte, what is your perspective on this?
While working with patients such as Jane, it is important for us to consider the challenges associated with achieving our goals of care. Clinically, our aim should be to achieve and sustain remission. Remission is defined by the American College of Rheumatology guidelines as an absence of disease activity, as characterized by a lack of clinical manifestations attributed to GPA or MPA on or off immunosuppressive therapy. Once we achieve remission, we should look to sustain it while balancing this goal against the burden of treatment. Note that therapies commonly used to treat GPA and MPA, such as glucocorticoids, can have adverse effects that impact patient health and quality of life. Let's take a closer look at some of these common approaches used to care for patients with severe active disease.
Common management approaches to induction and maintenance focus on broad-based immunosuppression, and more recently, the targeting of the humoral response with medications such as rituximab. In this approach, the goal of induction is to achieve remission with cyclophosphamide or rituximab products and initially glucocorticoids, which we aim to taper to allow for sustained remission without glucocorticoids, but with other immunosuppressive therapy. If this fails, glucocorticoids may be required for disease control during maintenance therapy alongside other immunosuppressants. Note that multiple disease, treatment, and patient-related factors that alter the risk of relapse are weighed when determining the optimal duration of therapy to maintain remission. Ultimately, treatment decisions for MPA and GPA are based on disease activity, damage, prognosis, and patient quality of life.
Yes, and I would say that despite improvements in the knowledge and diagnosis of GPA and MPA, there are several challenges to disease management we may encounter. These challenges may include timely diagnosis, achieving and maintaining relapse-free remission, toxicity from glucocorticoids, impact on organ function, and effect on patient quality of life. Let's take a moment to explore each of these challenges in detail, starting with diagnosis. Timely diagnosis remains a challenge for patients with GPA and MPA, often due to the relative rarity of the disease and nonspecific presentation we discussed earlier. About one-third of patients with GPA and MPA experience significant diagnostic delay of more than 6 months. Although many patients present with renal disease, remember that manifestations can stretch across multiple organ systems, and the presence of comorbidities may further complicate diagnosis, with patients often presenting with the comorbid conditions listed here. As a result, one study found that 16% of patients had referral symptoms for approximately 3 months before finally receiving their diagnosis. The issues discussed here help to underscore the importance of employing a careful and systematic approach to clinical assessment that can help us identify multi-organ system involvement and aid in timely diagnosis.
That's right. And after a diagnosis is made, we can then work towards achieving remission with induction. However, for many patients with GPA and MPA, achieving full remission during induction remains a challenge. Keep in mind that response to induction is variable, and many patients do not achieve full clinical remission within 6 months of initiating therapy. This was demonstrated in the RAVE clinical trial, where 36% and 47% of patients failed to show full clinical remission off glucocorticoids at 6 months after an induction regimen of rituximab or cyclophosphamide, respectively. In this study, full clinical remission was defined as a BVAS score of 0 with the patient off glucocorticoids. The BVAS, or Birmingham Vasculitis Activity Score, is a validated tool for assessment of disease activity in patients with many different forms of vasculitis. It includes scored items grouped into 9 organ systems, which capture a broad spectrum of clinical manifestations from vasculitis. Only features attributed to active vasculitis are considered.
In patients who do achieve clinical remission, goals of care shift towards sustaining remission. However, many patients struggle to remain relapse-free over the course of their maintenance treatment. The MAIN-RITSEN-1 clinical trial helps to illustrate the extent of relapse frequency in patients over time. In this trial, 115 patients with GPA or MPA in complete remission after combined glucocorticoids and pulse IV cyclophosphamide received maintenance therapy with either azathioprine out to 22 months or rituximab out to 18 months. Prednisone treatment was used on both treatment arms, starting at 1 mg/kg/day, followed by a gradual tapering, and then kept at a low dose, approximately 5 mg/day, for at least 18 months after randomization. Prednisone dose tapering and the decision to stop prednisone after month 18 were left to the discretion of each site investigator. Relapse rates were measured at months 28 and 60, with relapse defined as a reappearance or worsening of disease with BVAS greater than zero. Major relapse included involvement of at least one major organ and/or a life-threatening manifestation, while minor relapse was any non-major relapse that required mild treatment intensification. At month 28, 45% of patients in the azathioprine arm and 16% of patients in the rituximab arm experienced a minor or major relapse. Of those who were previously relapse-free, an additional 24% of patients in the azathioprine arm and 35% of those in the rituximab arm experienced a major or minor relapse. However, it's important to note that at the 60th month time point, patients had been off maintenance therapy, having received their last dose of azathioprine at month 22 and rituximab at month 18.
In patients with GPA or MPA, studies have shown several factors associated with increased risk of relapse. These include a diagnosis of GPA, a history of prior relapses, PR3 ANCA positivity, respiratory tract involvement, and discontinuation of maintenance therapy. Presence of any of these factors may warrant closer monitoring. Overall, some patients with GPA and MPA continue to struggle to achieve remission and experience relapses. As a result, many still receive glucocorticoids long-term.
That's an important point. Consider that the use of glucocorticoids long-term presents a challenge in care, as the toxicity from these agents has been well established. Even at lower doses, prolonged use of glucocorticoids can be associated with substantial morbidity. A common issue includes increased risk of infection. Among patients in the ANCA disease registry of the Glomerular Disease Collaborative Network, or GDCN, patients receiving glucocorticoid therapy for more than 6 months had significantly greater incidence of infections versus those not using glucocorticoids after 6 months, with a difference of 0.64 versus 0.39 infections per person year.
Beyond infection, glucocorticoids are also associated with a wide variety of adverse events that can be measured by validated tools such as the Glucocorticoid Toxicity Index, or GTI. The GTI was developed by an international group of subspecialty physician experts as a clinician-facing measure of glucocorticoid toxicity over time. In clinical trials, the GTI has shown toxicity of glucocorticoid use across multiple domains, such as blood pressure, neuropsychiatric toxicity, glucose and lipid metabolism, body mass index, bone density, steroid myopathy, skin toxicity, and infection. Thinking beyond glucocorticoid toxicity, we should note that disease activity can affect renal function in patients with GPA and MPA. In a 2015 study examining results across multiple key ANCA-associated vasculitis trials, researchers found kidney involvement was common, with many patients showing a glomerular filtration rate less than 50 and proteinuria. Overall, early and sustained remission is associated with improved patient outcomes, but can remain a challenge in the context of treatment toxicity and burden of disease.
Yes, and the combination of disease activity and treatment toxicity also place a burden on patient quality of life. Patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis report reduced quality of life, including physical and emotional aspects, compared with the general population. Though not specifically validated for ANCA-associated vasculitis, tools such as the SF-36 can help us quantify the effect of disease on quality of life compared to the general population. Scores for each dimension on the SF-36 range from 0 to 100, with higher scores indicating better health-related quality of life. Data from a cross-sectional study conducted at National Referral Center in Cochin Hospital in Paris, France, showed a reduction in quality of life as measured by the SF-36 between the general population and patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis. Moreover, the reduction in quality of life seen in patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis was comparable to that seen in other chronic diseases.
Additional factors to consider for patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis may include the effects on employment or finances and general emotional challenges. In the French study we've referenced previously, 50% of patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis considered their disease to have hindered their careers. And a UK study found that 26% of patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis were considered work disabled. Financial constraints are not uncommon for patients with GPA or MPA, as management of these conditions and associated sequelae can be costly and invasive. And of course, emotional challenges from this disease are common. In a study across US, UK, and Canadian patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis, 86% expressed concerns about the future and reported experiences that affected their quality of life, including fatigue, joint pain, and mental health. Further research is needed to better understand disease status and health-related quality of life, especially when patients and physicians may have different priorities regarding treatments. While we as clinicians may want to focus more on objective aspects, such as organ function, it's important to note that patients rank quality of life domains, such as managing pain and fatigue, as high priorities when selecting a treatment regimen.
Now that we have the chance to review common approaches and challenges in management, let's take a look back at our patient, Jane, to see how this all comes together. After diagnosis, Jane was started on induction therapy with a combination of rituximab, 2 doses of 1 gram each, 2 weeks apart, and prednisone 1 mg/kg/day, with a planned gradual taper to no more than 5 mg by week 22. Jane is returning after 2 months on treatment, reporting improvement in her sinus and joint symptoms, but continues to have fatigue. She has also noticed weight gain since starting glucocorticoids, experiencing mood swings and insomnia, and has been having difficulty controlling her blood sugar. Labs show elevated hemoglobin A1c to 8.2, stable eGFR, and urine analysis with continued hematuria and proteinuria, though her ESR has improved somewhat. Consider, what aspects of Jane's presentation point to a persistent, severe, active disease? What challenges you and Jane may encounter as you continued care for her GPA? And how you might go about evaluating how well your approach is meeting goals of care?
That's right. And as we look for ways to further care for our patients like Jane with GPA or MPA, we might find opportunities by understanding the roles of different pathways and mechanisms in the etiology of these diseases. As we discussed previously, the humoral response does play a key role in development of ANCA and neutrophil activation, while priming and recruitment of neutrophils is amplified by elements of the alternative complement system. Dr. Villa-Forte, can you walk us through a closer look at the role of this pathway?
Of course. As we look closer at the process, we see that C5a binding to C5a receptors on the surface of neutrophils plays a critical role in the priming and recruitment of these cells. Primed neutrophils present surface antigens to which ANCA binds to activate the neutrophils. Primed and activated neutrophils then migrate to and infiltrate vascular endothelium, where they release destructive mediators through nidrosis and degranulation that lead to inflammation and vascular damage. In the process, they cause the release of more C5a, which acts to prime and recruit additional neutrophils to the site of inflammation. In this way, the complement amplification loop is enhanced, leading to progressive vascular inflammation and damage. Although it may introduce complexity to our understanding of disease, it is important for us to consider the range of mechanisms involved in GPA and MPA pathophysiology. Ultimately, this understanding may help us to be better informed about these diseases as we work to achieve balance in our approach to care.
In this presentation, we've worked to cover a host of topics we hope will enhance your understanding of GPA and MPA and your approach to care. As a summary, we invite you to consider the following: that GPA and MPA are chronic and progressive autoimmune diseases that cause small to medium vessel vasculitis, damaging vasculature throughout the body. That a careful, systematic approach to clinical assessment across multiple organ systems is key to timely diagnosis. That common approaches to management seek to induce and maintain remission by targeting the humoral response and/or using broad-based immunosuppression and have resulted in improvements.
However, challenges in diagnosis and management of disease include difficulty achieving and maintaining remission, treatment toxicity, impact on organ function, and effect on patient quality of life. And finally, the opportunities to further care may start with understanding the mechanisms involved in pathophysiology of GPA and MPA, including both humoral and complement-mediated pathways. Thank you so much, Dr. Cortazar, for joining me today. And we'd also like to thank you, our audience. We hope that you enjoyed our presentation.